And first of all, let me remember you that the conference will be recorded. Well, actually, it's being recorded. During the afternoon session, I have the honor to count with the presence of Mr. Pablo Hernández de Cos, Governor of the Bank of Spain. I would like to thank him. I did it already in Spanish, but I do it again in English, to thank him for his great interest and availability to participate in our conference. Let me just give a couple of words about his CV. He holds a PhD in economics and graduate in economics and law. After he carried out a management program at the ISE school, he joined the Bank of Spain in 1997, where he has held many posts of responsibility until being designated governor in 2018. I would like to highlight he has been Director General of Economics, Statistics and Research of the Bank of Spain and Advisor of the Executive Board of the European Central Bank. The title of his keynote speech is going to be Statistical Production and Economic Policy Making, a View from a Central Bank. Pablo, welcome again, and I give you the floor. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Juan Manuel. Thank you, President, and thank you to El Instituto Nacional de Estadística for the kind invitation to participate in this virtual event. Let me, of course, first congratulate the Instituto Nacional de Estadística on this anniversary. Since its creation in the very difficult times after the Spanish Civil War, the ICT has continuously grown in stature, and today I think we all agree that it boasts the highest standards in terms of professionalism and credibility. So congratulations to all the current and of course also to the former INE team for this achievement. I guess it's obvious to all of us that this conference has taken place or is taking place in an extraordinary moment, the one created by the second wave of the COVID-19 pandemic, whose first wave created a dramatic loss of human lives and generated a huge and an unprecedented negative economic impact. A crisis that, in my view, has shown again the importance of statistics, of good statistics, to make the right policy decisions. Indeed, we live in a society overcrowded with data. Every decision we take and every transaction or movement we make are reflected in some or another database. But this per se has not necessarily increased our real information or our knowledge. Many of those data are not structured, lack a precise definition, or do not follow a specific methodology. So it's not always useful for making the right diagnosis, and therefore it's not useful to make the right decisions. And this is precisely why statistics, and in particular official statistics, are so important, as they precisely transform data into real information. We need these statistics to make sound decisions, since policymaking, or at least good policymaking, should rely on timely, exhaustive, and detailed information provided by official statistics. Unsurprisingly, statistical production plays a prominent role in central banks. Central banks have a long-standing tradition in producing and analyzing monetary and financial information. Central banks are also known by having staff who are highly experienced. Central banks do have very good raw materials as well, benefiting from our key role as banking regulators and supervisors. And I should also stress central banks have also the autonomy, the independence, an element that has also greatly helped enhance the credibility of our statistical output. In the particular case of the Bank of Spain, as part of the Eurosystem, as a participant of the single supervisory mechanism, and given our legal responsibilities for the proper functioning and stability of the financial system, we regularly collect a wealth of financial and supervisory information from credit institutions, and we are also responsible for designing financial reporting. A task that we've always assumed to be complementary and in close coordination to those performed by INE. Indeed, some of the key statistics produced by the Bank of Spain are part of the Spanish National Statistical Plan, including some macro statistics, such as the balance of payments and the financial accounts, And more broadly, I think I can stress and we can be proud of the long-standing tradition of close and candid cooperation between our two institutions. This close cooperation has been fundamental to guarantee the quality of the Spanish statistical system, and I want also to take this occasion to thank INE and his president for this. This is the starting point, so let me now concentrate on some of the challenges, three challenges that, in my view, we are all facing and that are relevant in the current context. First, we can all agree that the statistics have been undergoing a revolution in the last few years. In particular, important technological advances have increased the availability to process huge amounts of data. Policymakers and analysts have now more and more information and also have the possibility of applying more sophisticated models that can be used to design more refined economic policy responses and answering more complex questions. Some of these evolutionary changes stem from the experience of the great financial crisis of the last decade. Then it was felt that only the availability of detailed information on economic agents' position, including, by the way, cross-border ones, would allow the relevant policy authorities to thoroughly analyze the exposures of an increasingly interconnected global financial system and to better understand the monetary policy transmission and the massive deleveraging that followed the global financial crisis. To meet this objective, the Eurosystem promoted a number of projects based on granular information, and the key word here is, of course, granular. This included Anacredit to build up a central credit register at the European level, the Securities Holding Statistics Database, which contains exhaustive security by security information on European portfolios, and money market statistical reporting, where daily information at the transaction level is collected from financial institutions. And the Bank of Spain also reacted swiftly to this challenge, even well before the global financial crisis. Since the 80s, we are fortunate to have an exhaustive database of the annual balance sheets and the profit and loss accounts of Spanish firms, the so-called Central de Balances, whose inception was one of the landmarks as far as the set of statistics produced by Bank of Spain is concerned. The data contains also a very valuable sample of firms voluntarily providing quarterly information. Moreover, the balance of payments and the international investment position have been historically produced by relying on mainly micro data. And from the outset of the century, we have conducted every 3 years, which will be every 2 years in the future, a wave of the survey of household finances, which offers a very rich picture of some of the key economic and financial decisions taken by Spanish households. I have also to mention that in 2013, we overhauled the information compiled by the Central Credit Register, switching more towards a very complete granular database in order to strengthen our micro and macro prudential supervisory mechanisms. We can safely say that all this micro information that has helped the Bank of Spain to better perform our functions and has allowed us to address flexibly both analytical work and statistical compilation. However, I want also to stress that moving towards a statistical landscape broadly relying on microdata requires deep changes in a number of processes. As automation is of the essence, new techniques need to be used to manage this data, including the necessary quality checks, and staff skills have to be upgraded accordingly. And we know that this can prove very demanding, particularly since data quality management in microdata is a very cumbersome process. Let me be clear here, microdata per se do not ensure high quality statistics, but it is true that if you have microdata, you can check the quality of the data, pinpoint where the problems are, and potentially revise them. An important issue in this regard, thus for ensuring data quality, is the proper identification of economic agents. In a complex and globalized world, and in particular in a monetary union where domestic transactions correspond to an area larger than your own country, as is the context in Spain, the identification of counterparts to maintain high-quality statistics is simply essential. Since the European national central banks can only properly pursue their functions by previously identifying the financial corporations under their scrutiny and the non-financial counterparts of financial market transactions, we have created our own register, the Register of Institutions and Affiliates Database. But in addition, or an additional key step forward to ensure there is adequate identification of agents at the European level would be to enhance cooperation in this field between the European Statistical System and the Eurosystem. And this could be done, for example, by integrating the reference data directories that would allow and would afford us better knowledge of the relations between subsidiaries and the parent companies, which are so important for understanding the effects of globalization. Moreover, the ESCB has contributed to the creation of a worldwide network to set up a global identifier for legal entities, the Legal Entity Identifier, LEI. I think there is a broad consensus that the widespread use of this identifier among institutions and firms globally would greatly favor the monitoring of financial stability and the compilation of statistics. And this is precisely why in Spain, some institutions, including INE and Bank of Spain, are promoting the use of the LEI and facilitating its implementation in our country. Globalization also poses significant challenges for the compilation of macro statistics, on which, again, our institutions cooperate very closely. Multinational enterprises organize their activity and finances globally, and the complexity of allocating them correctly across countries can only be afforded by data sharing, nationally and internationally, and perhaps even by resorting to centralized data reporting and quality checking. Obtaining information from multinational firms as groups would allow reportings to be simplified, while at the same time ensuring a consistent cross-country recording of transactions, assets, and of course, liabilities as well. A second issue I wanted to tackle today is related to the fact that this statistical revolution I've just described has gone hand in hand with substantial progress in empirical economics and modeling. In this regard, some years ago, macro literature often relied on a representative agent model. That was a natural consequence of computational limitations. However, the aggregation of individual behavior does not in general coincide with the behavior of one average individual. That's why this literature is now moving towards models with heterogeneous agents, each with distinct behavior and a distinct reaction to policies, which allows not only for a more accurate representation of the economy, but also for the analysis of distributional issues such as inequality that have become so important in all countries. For such sophisticated analysis, again, detailed micro information is key. This is also true for empirical economics and in particular for the evaluation of economic policies, as we know that many policies target very specific groups of agents according to some individual or location-specific characteristics. And we know that the effects of policies depend on many individual features as well as on other contextual issues, which again notably increases the heterogeneity of the effects of policy measures. As a consequence, access to massive data that do not limit the scope of the analysis on account of small sample biases is key for the evaluation of economic policies. As I've stressed many times recently, and in particular over the last few months during the COVID crisis, the key to understanding the degree of success of policies is to proceed with proper and timely evaluations based on sufficient background information. This is the only way to ascertain to what extent policies are working or need adjustment in terms of the timing, magnitude, and focus. In the current context, for example, global authorities are in uncharted waters in terms of the dimension of the crisis and its multiple ramifications, and it is therefore very difficult to calibrate the economic policy response. In my view, only good and timely data can allow us to design an optimal policy reaction in such a complex context. The present crisis has also stressed the importance of having data in real time. In the last few months, information on the use of payment cards, traffic on roads and at airports, electricity consumption, mobility, Google searches, and so on, have been fundamental for assessing the magnitude of the economic slump and the subsequent timed recovery. These indicators will hardly join the compact and methodological sound realm of official statistics, but I think we should also pay attention and invest some resources in understanding them, familiarizing ourselves with the use and incorporating them into our forecasting models. Probably some of these indicators could be temporarily considered experimental statistics, a label statistical institutions may use to explore new fields and to convey to users the as yet not fully sound nature of this data. In parallel, I think we should improve the timeliness of official statistics as much as possible. And in this connection, the recent shorter time lag in production of INES CPI and GDP flash estimates are very good examples. In our case, at the Bank of Spain, we have also been able to obtain some real-time granular information that is being very useful for assessing the current difficult conditions. As regards information from banks, for example, the data provided by the Central Credit Register is now more necessary than ever for assessing the risk of granting credit and the level of aggregated risk of the economy. And indeed, this information has been crucial in the design and in the assessment of the effectiveness of the measures adopted during this period, including moratorium loans or public guarantees on lending, among others. Last April, we also made use of the Central Balance Sheet Data Office database to conduct a quick survey of a sample of non-financial companies in order to capture their initial reactions to the lockdown. Again, this information proved very helpful in guiding our assessment of the initial impact of the pandemic on the Spanish firms and therefore on the Spanish economy. In all these tasks, in particular in performing evaluation of public policies, I believe, and I want to stress this, that the role of external analysts and researchers can be pivotal. In this regard, I see only advantages from making information produced by authorities public to the scientific community. Evaluation of public policies should not be the responsibility of public institutions only. On the contrary, data availability would pave the way for evaluations by the independent researchers with a clear potential for enriching our knowledge on the impact of public policies. This would increase the number of cross-checks and would ensure more robust results by looking at the same questions from different angles. This would open the way towards improving the policy-making process by conferring a greater weight on evidence and evaluation techniques. My impression is that the more ambitious we are in this field, the better the assessment by researchers we are going to have. Indeed, it is a fact that countries with more open data typically enjoy larger than average high-quality economic evaluations. That's the reason why we have created a data laboratory at the Bank of Spain, BILAB, and intend to gradually open up our data to the scientific community. We have started offering the annual financial statements of about 1 million companies per year, made available thanks to the agreement signed with the Colegio de Registradores Mercantiles. As part of our medium-term strategic plan, we are currently analyzing the legal and technical conditions to broaden the databases disseminated at this laboratory and to ease access to the data. Currently, it's only possible to access the data lab using the data room located on our premises, but we are preparing the tools to make such access also possible by a remote and secure means. Naturally, a dilemma arises between the advantages of opening up our microdata to society, in particular for scientific purposes and for improving the design of policies, and the statistical confidentiality that reporting agents wish to keep. I think this is something that in the past has been biased, clearly biased, on the size of excessively restrictive access to data. But given modern anonymization techniques, my impression is that the picture should now become more balanced in favor of opening up our institutions and data to society. INES own laboratory is a good example of this movement, and I can in fact affirm that some Bank of Spain economists are already enjoying access to INES Data Lab, and their experience shows the potential advantages and benefits of cooperation between institutions and researchers. Conceivably, we could think about a further step forward, linking and federating our data labs, or we could think about the possibility of establishing safe hubs of granular information where data from different institutions are shared with every guarantee of retaining statistical secrecy and confidentiality. By way of example, in some Nordic countries, there is a consortium of public institutions which share the data not only with their own analysts, but also with the scientific community. In addition, it would also be worth strengthening the possibilities of having access to administrative registers of other institutions and to allow the matching of different databases. The value of microdata sets increases exponentially when they can be combined, including the granular information of one data set in the observations of another. The amount of research possibility here is really huge. Therefore, we should make every effort to achieve these types of data set combinations through the above mentioned safe hubs, through a consortium, or by any other means. Another related issue is the importance of providing all the observations making up a given register. A large amount of observation is by itself important as it allows the study of specific groups of agents with sufficient accuracy. But it is also crucial when it comes to merging different data sets. If an administrative register is reduced to some subset of observations, then the chances of finding the same agents in a different data set decrease dramatically. This is of particular importance in the case of surveys containing important information to be merged with some registers. Surveys usually have a much smaller sample size. Therefore, the number of observations in common with an artificially reduced register would be very low or even zero. The path to striking a balance between giving access to the research community to the more interesting databases while ensuring confidentiality and anonymization could much benefit from the experience of other institutions. And to this end, a few years ago, several central banks set in motion the so-called INEXTA network. At present, this network comprises central banks, including the participation of the ECB, Statistical Directorate, and other statistical institutes like Eurostat. In this forum, participants from the statistical areas and data labs exchange experiences in the management of microdata, the aim being to guarantee the harmonization of certain procedures and share best practices in this domain. Access to the information in the hands of the private sources is also a very interesting field where we can make further progress. INE had a very good experience this year in exploiting data from mobile phones to analyze citizens' mobility in different cities and regions, easing and lessening the cost of developing such statistics with the help of new technologies. The need to better understand and organize the transition from customer data privately used by service corporations to citizens' microdata of interest for public analysis has to be studied thoroughly. That is why I welcome and congratulate INE on recently launching a business-to-government working group under the name of Working Group about the role of official statistics on data stewardship. In this working group, key players will reflect on ways to provide access to private data while maintaining and promoting ethical principles. In fact, I consider there is a need to break the quasi-monopoly which some big tech companies have on personal data, something which requires a coordinated international effort. The European Data Strategy announced by the European Commission a few months ago aimed at public-private sector collaboration in data sharing is a good example in this respect. It is also important to recall the usefulness of statistical information for public opinion. Central banks' information is quite often of a very technical nature, but at the same time, some variables, such as, for example, interest rates, have a strong impact on household finances and small and medium enterprises, whereas information about recent developments on key economic and financial variables are also very relevant to public opinion. Therefore, accessible, transparent, clear statistics are also needed. In our case, we are continuously striving to improve how statistics are conveyed to society and to adapt our communication to different types of users. In this regard, a couple of years ago, we conducted a survey of the uses of our statistical information. The results offer a useful guidance about some key issues. Following the input from this survey, we have in recent years tried to exploit new technologies to display data, including more charts, interactive menus, dashboards, etc. And just a few days ago, we launched an application which will allow users to have our statistical information readily available on their mobile services and mobile devices. Let me now move briefly, briefly, to the third and final topic I wanted to tackle in my intervention today. As we have seen, data, whether microdata or aggregate variables, are an essential ingredient for analyzing and designing economic policies. But at the same time, reporting data are not free. This always means a burden on reporting agents, and I think that the responsibility of all of us as authorities is to minimize that burden and establish the mechanisms which ensure data collection as efficient as possible and smooth the ensuing interactions with agents to check data quality. In a sense, collecting microdata may help reduce the reporting burden on economic agents, such as banks, investment funds, non-financial companies, etc., if they are able to replace other aggregate requirements imposed by the authorities. Moreover, these requirements may sometimes change over time, thus demanding a continuous and costly adaptation of the agency reporting schemes, including complex IT developments. But in any case, data collection imposes certain costs on agents, and therefore, public institutions should be sensitive to the demands to establish an efficient system to collect information, avoiding overlaps and harnessing synergies. In order to tackle this issue, there are already some data sharing mechanisms in place across statistical institutions. Indeed, the special relations between INE and the Bank of Spain, the National Accounts and Balance of Payments fields, is a good example. Yet, more can probably be done both at the national and domestic level. On the international front, there are good practices we can explore. A case in point is the one in Portugal, where non-financial companies have a sort of single window to report the data required by the main Portuguese authorities, tax agency, National Statistical Institute, Mercantile Register, Central Bank. In particular, our neighbor has been able to build a single data platform to which every authority can subsequently resort to obtain the information they are entitled to access. I've seen that in the Spanish National Statistical Plan for next year, there is a reference to a project setting up a Sistema Integrado de Información de Empresas, which I think is along the same lines, and it could then contribute to significantly reducing firms' reporting burden in the future. As concerns financial information, we should, of course, also be open to more efficient financial reporting and statistical production at the Bank of Spain and at the ESCB level. The Bank of Spain is very much committed to this goal. In fact, we already have a strategy to simplify and rationalize regulatory reporting that is starting to bear results. The main aim is to alleviate the reporting burden and to improve data management by institutions and by the Bank of Spain itself. On top of that, various initiatives have been taken as part of our strategic plan, which runs to 2024, dealing with data management and transparency. The goal here is to have a better knowledge of the overall data sets available at the institution, which may point to some synergies, overlapping and gaps, and to establish good data governance procedures and a technically sound platform to host and exploit all the, that information. At the European level, several initiatives are in motion as well. First, the European Commission has asked the European Banking Authority to conduct a feasibility study to explore the possibilities for statistical, supervisory, and resolution reporting to converge, thus reducing the reporting cost of financial institutions. The ESCB proposal to the EBA feasibility report published last September is based on three main avenues of work. First, the Common Standard Data Dictionary. Second, the harmonization of reporting formats, the removal of duplications and improved data sharing. And third, increased cooperation between authorities and reporting agents. Linked to this project, the ESCB is developing an integrated reporting framework whose aim is to reduce the reporting burden for banks and to ensure the effort made by any credit institution that does not depend on the particular euro-area country in which a bank is resident. To this end, the purpose is to integrate the existing ESCB statistical data requirements for banks into a single standardized reporting framework, making it homogeneous across the European Union. There are also initiatives to explore the role played by national central banks as producers of statistics at the euro-area level. For many statistical products and for different stages of the statistical process, central banks mainly rely on their own capabilities, running different IT systems and developing autonomous projects in each country. Here, some synergies can probably be harnessed and cost reduced if collaboration between central banks is further strengthened in that statistical process. So allow me to conclude. Modern technologies offer a wide range of possibilities for obtaining and assessing information at much lower cost than in the past. Here we have a technological challenge, but another we face is to recruit our staff and to provide them with the skills needed to address these new issues. This may be a long process, but we need to tackle it now. As I've tried to explain today, the potential benefits for economic policymaking are crucial, are very significant. At the same time, there are other obstacles in the way of improving our knowledge of the rapidly changing world. These have more to do with institutional factors and even with some cultural traits. They are not easy to remove, but we cannot deny we have a major role to play in gradually changing our mindset and overcoming the barriers which today hamper, for example, data sharing among institutions and open data for scientific purposes. My impression is that we need to be very ambitious if we do not want to miss the train. We also have more possibilities of succeeding if we join forces with other institutions, both at the national and the international level. Thank you very much for your attention.
Much, Governor, for your talk. I share many of the opinions you made, but actually, I must confess that I was very attracted by your proposals about the sharing or a consortium of data labs and in general to allow the access of our data sets under, of course, the restrictions of confidentiality and anonymization to researchers and to people who are going to analyze or to evaluate public policies. I fully agree with you that this is something we need to undertake. Actually, we are having an initiative to try to make INE the central lab for administrative registers in the administration. We are working in with this idea in this direction. But of course, the possibility of consortium with other institutions, as the Bank of Spain, in terms of our data labs, is something we have to consider, and we have to take into account. I fully agree with you that this is a train we should not miss. With respect to the access to privately held data, the crisis has shown us the importance and the relevance of this type of data, because they provide us with two characteristics you have mentioned that are very good for our researchers and for us, which are granularity and high frequency. This is something that somehow we have missed in the traditional official statistics, and we have somehow used them sometimes without, as you mentioned also, without enough care. I think we need to undertake a sort of transition. That would probably be the experimental data or the experimental statistics that are a point between the direct use of these new data sources and the standard official statistics. This medium point that would be just enough to take some time to reflect about the performance of this data. And of course, in a further step, to include it in the official statistics. Finally, I thank you and acknowledge that you have mentioned our Sistema Integrado de Información de Empresas. It's a clear project for us. And as you mentioned, as a really good way to avoid excess burden to informants. We are also working on it, although as you can understand, it's a difficult project in terms of taking it into the right track. There are many institutions implicated, and we have to take some time to develop it. Actually, we had this morning the president of the INE Stats INE Portugal, and they took some years to put this project working. I had already had some conversations with him, and I hope we will take less time than they did, because at least we can learn from their experience, and we can probably avoid some mistakes they made on the way through. But I agree, it's also a very important project. We will have time afterwards to discuss probably and to put all these ideas on a paper and work through. I have no doubts of it. From my side, I'm really available to follow and to discuss these proposals, because, as you mentioned, they are crucial for our nation and for the Spanish economy in general, I would say. Okay, sorry I didn't mention that we had an open chat with some questions, and we also, since we are in elections day somehow, in we also put a poll just with a question, just to know what the audience, the attendees thinks about this. Well, let me start with the questions. I have got, I guess, in the chat one which is fairly. Oh, I can see two of them now. They seem to be fairly interesting, but please feel free to answer them or not. The first one says, under the framework on the memorandum of understanding between ESCB and Eurostat, how do you assess the relations among ESS and the ESCB? Do you think there is room for improvement in the collaboration among both systems? If you want, I can give you a second question, and just how do you imagine European and national statistics in 5 years?
Well, maybe I can start with the second question, since it's only my imagination that will work independently of whether reality will be according to that imagination. No, I think I have to confess that the content of the speech I was given, which as usual was prepared by my staff, you know, but that I share many or all of the points that were stressed, were already in my head when I was a researcher myself. Okay, so I think the many of the issues that you were also mentioning, President, when summarizing, by the way, very well my intervention, are the those that I would like to have for the national, but also for the European statistical system in 5 years' time. This issue of data sharing to researchers is absolutely crucial. And by the way, I think it's even an obligation for us. I think it's something that even citizens should be demanding to all of us, because it doesn't make any sense that in the current context on which transparency is of the essence in any public activity, even in many of the private activities, we are not able to provide to researchers all the, in particular, all the microdata that that we have. And I'm pretty sure that we will end there. I don't have any doubt. The question is whether we will do it in an efficient way. And you were mentioning, Juan Manuel, very, very interesting idea that I was also mentioning in my speech about how this collaboration between institutions should work. I think there is a lot of cost saving of doing this together, and of course there is also a lot of synergies that could be obtained by doing them ourselves. That's for me one of the main priorities, and I should put all the efforts to reach this, not only, by the way, again, not at the domestic level, but also at the European level. Many of the discussions that we are having, for example, in our current monetary policy issues, many of them can only be answered with this micro data that it is obtained in real time or as updated as possible. This should be and is would be as absolutely crucial in order to make the right policy decisions. And I'm talking about monetary policy on which, for example, inflation, the measure of inflation is something that we have very good real-time information. But of course, we talk about fiscal policy in general, the possibility of having this micro data and real-time information, the combination of these two issues would be absolutely crucial. That's for me one issue that is absolutely crucial. And the second one, of course, is the one I was mentioning at the very end of my intervention, which is the cost efficiency of all our reporting and the reporting burden that we create on different agents. No? I think it's so in the particular case of banks, when we look internally at the bank, the number of requests that we do almost every day to banks in the different domains of banking supervision, of banking conduct, of banking resolution, I mean, it's absolutely amazing. And it, to a certain extent, it's even crazy. And also, do have to take this also very seriously. And of course, this is not only for banking information, but also I think it applies for many of the relevant information, in particular for non-financial corporations, but even for individual agents, you know, for consumers or even the tax taxpayers. You know? So I think if we take these two objectives as crucial and we pay all the attention that they deserve, I would be very happy with in 5 years time to say that we've reached. A complete structural change in the statistical domain. And then on the first question, well, I have to first, I'm not currently very familiarized how this connection and this collaboration between ESCB and Eurostat is working. My perception, in particular, when I was working for the European Central Bank, I was to a certain extent also there connected to the statistical work that was done by the European Central Bank, and the connection with the ECB was very, very close. Of course, here at the Bank of Spain, the connection with Eurostat and the connection through, but also individually, of the bank with Eurostat is also very, very close, but I guess it can always be improved. No? And of course, the connection between real and economic variables. This is something that in the economic analysis we've been emphasizing for years, and in particular after the global financial crisis is absolutely crucial. We cannot understand the economics of the real economy without analyzing the financial domain, and the opposite, of course, is completely and fully true. So enhancing this relationship between the European system of central banks, national central banks, and Eurostat, I think is, of course, absolutely essential. But I guess the spirit has always been for this collaboration to be very, very strong. So I don't see major problems there.
Yeah, let me just emphasize what you said, your last words. I think at least, let me put it in this way, that at least in Spain, this collaboration is very, I guess, between our institutions is very good. Of course, it can be improved, and I'm concerned for that, and I hope it's going to be the case. But also, I have the perception that at a European level, this collaboration is quite good in terms of the European system of central banks and the European statistical systems. That's my impression. But of course, there is always room for improvement. That's clear. Okay. So let me just go now to the question of the poll. The question was, how could we reinforce the role of official institutions in order to foster the access to timeline and more granular data to the researcher community? Well, that's a question that somehow has to do with your presentation, and we have been discussing a bit about that. And we have we had four different answers. Answer A was there should be a national institution to coordinate the access to this data. B, it should be a better regulated at European at national level. C, this access should not be granted under any conditions in order to guarantee data protection. Wow. Well, we have a 5% of our attendees that think this, right? So it's the access should be only possible in secure centers controlled by the official data holder. Okay, let's see. We have a majority of votes that go for answer B about the better regulation at the European and national level. We could agree on this. Also, the first, there should be a national institution to coordinate access to this data. Okay, at some point it could be possible, or a consortium, that's clear. I don't think they are exclusive, right? I mean, the answers, you could probably subscribe different ones. For sure, I would not subscribe C. That's clear. That's clear. But the rest is always a matter of taste and of subtilities. Let me put it in this way. We had a last question that showed up. This is probably a question you might like to answer, Pablo, because they are asking about your app, the statistics app. Have you tested how it's running your statistic app? Can you give us some data? Is the Bank of Spain working in other dissemination tools?
Yeah,
sort of provocative question.
I have to confess that I don't have the numbers. But as soon as we have them, of course, we will also provide this information public. You know, I think it was a very good initiative. You know, as I was mentioning during my intervention, it's not only important to produce data, as we generally all do, but at the same time to communicate this data in the right way. You know, and this is something that in my experience here at the bank, probably we didn't pay much attention to this, no? But this is something that is also that is demanded again by citizens. No, they want to know this data, and they want us to publish the data in a way that they can understand the data. No? And that's probably as important as producing the data in itself. No? For sure, we didn't pay so much attention to this topic in the past. But here we have also to accept that we are in a learning process. No? This is a relatively new domain for us, and the interaction with consumers of the data will be very important in order to improve our dissemination tools.
Mm-hmm. Now it's indeed a very interesting initiative, because you know this morning I was mentioning this. We have new data. We have new production processes in official statistics, and we must have also new dissemination tools.
Yeah.
Because our users have also changed. 10 years ago, they got to us through internet books at this type, or papers. But nowadays, many people, the only contact with reality that some group of people do have are mobile phones. You get all information, and many people get all information from them, in terms of they look at the news, they play, they communicate with others, and they receive information from the apps. Mm-hmm. So in this sense, I think it's a very good initiative in terms of innovative way of disseminating statistical information.
Yeah.
It's clear. Okay, so I must thank you again for your talk and for your participation in this conference. 75 years old, we are not as old as you.
nobody is perfect.
although you know, we have some precedent, I mean some answers from the 1850 till out nowadays, but the name has changed and also the somehow the principles, but I would say it's a long history, and as you said, I hope it's going to last and to. I don't think I will celebrate with the INE the 150th anniversary, but I hope. And I hope it will last, and it will keep his central position in the production of the statistics in Spain. Thank you very much again, Governor, and I.